I love you. I appreciate this church, the people that make this church. We truly are blessed. I tell them, everywhere I go, we have the best church that I've ever been a part of. And I don't say that just because I'm the pastor. I say it because it really is the truth. Whether I were just a member of the church or the pastor or lay leader, it makes no difference. You're a special people, a wonderful body, and I truly love you and I appreciate you. Just the unity, the fact that there really are people you can count on here on so many levels. If you need prayer, there are prayer warriors at this church. There are people that will take up the burden alongside of you and carry it with you. There are people, plural, there are so many people, wonderful people in this church. If you called them in the midnight hour and all you knew was their face, I'm telling you that there's some wonderful people in this church that would wake up with you in the midnight hour. And that's rare and it's special. It's what the church should look like. I'm not saying we're perfect. Lord knows that's not the truth, but you're wonderful people, and I praise God, and I'm humbled to be a part of this body, and I thank you for being you. But Lord, I love you, and I thank you, God. I praise you, Lord, for giving us the sweet gift, Lord, of your body, the fellowship, Lord, of saints, sisters, and brothers in Christ, Lord. And I just pray today a blessing, a covering, Lord, over this body. Lord, that spirit of unity continue to be maintained. Father, Lord, that true Christian love, Lord, would so fill and flood our hearts, God, that it just exude from us. Not only within the confines of this building, Lord, but every place that we go, may we bear forth the image of our Father in heaven. God, I pray, Lord, that we'd be Christ-like in our speech, Lord, that we'd be loving, Lord, not only in the walls of the church, God, but may we be peculiar when we go out, Lord, that people see something in us, God, that attracts them to you. May it be the fruit of the Holy Spirit abiding in us, God. And as I come this morning, Lord, again, I give you praise for this body, Lord, for this fellowship, Lord, for all the many needs within the body today. God, you know them all personally, individually, Lord. You see every tear. You hear every prayer, God. You are faithful. Even when we don't understand, God, you are faithful. God, I just pray this morning you'd make ready every heart, every mind and spirit today to receive of you your word, the bread of life. God, as your servant, I come humbly before you this day, confessing, Lord, publicly and unto you, God, that I am absolutely helpless and hopeless apart from you. I'm nothing without you. God, without you, there's nothing I can say or do. I can't even stand, Lord. You know that's the truth. The very breath in my body, Lord, you placed there this day. You caused my eyes to open, oh, Lord. What am I apart from you, Lord? I'm nothing. I'm just a tool in the Master's hand. Use me this day however you see fit for your glory. Let your word go forth this day, Lord, and not the word of a man, that you and you alone be seen and glorified in this place today in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Before I bring the word, I want to share this school of discipleship with you, and I want you to understand what it is and where it come from. 2010, I reference and I read to you regularly our core commitments as a church. The first is a commitment to the Word of God, to be committed. And this is a commitment from the church as well as it is individually. God had given a promise to this church, and I wish you could see. For some of you that have been with us for a long time, you have seen. But others, you walk in and all you know is what you see now. But I'm telling you that God has richly and abundantly blessed this church and in ways that I cannot even explain to adequately give him glory. And I'm not just talking about numbers. Numbers really don't mean a whole lot to me. If you're not growing in the Lord, what difference does it make that we fill up another chair? That's just the honest truth. This isn't McDonald's where we're aiming to serve another billion. We're aiming to get souls into heaven. We're aiming to see spiritual growth. We're aiming to see lives transformed for the glory of God. So when God had given this vision for these commitments, God had simply let me know as a pastor that if we would make a commitment as a church, there would be a season of blessing for this church. And God had said, if you would make that commitment as individuals, that there'd be a season of blessing in your life personally for making these commitments. Now, here's what I can tell you. We've done it as a church, and God has been faithful to His promise. And there have been individuals in this church that I've seen apply these things in their life, and God has blessed them in ways they can't even begin to describe. I'm talking about from miracles of healing to salvation in their family. I'm talking about financial blessings and God restoring a messed up financial situation. I'm talking about the whole gamut of things. But these three commitments are this: a commitment to the Word of God, to read it, to study it, to know it, to get into the Word. And I know we've got 101 excuses for why we can't, but it's just that, a commitment. The truth is, every commitment we make in this life, we've got 101 excuses to bail out on it if we're looking for them. Commitment to the Word, a commitment to discipleship, and a commitment to serve. That commitment to discipleship changed everything. This is where this school of discipleship comes in. This commitment to discipleship as a pastor. I want you to understand, as the church, as the pastor of this church, we made the decision we're going to change the way we do business. That if God had laid this on my heart, I can't just get up and preach this to you. We've got to be committed to it, to the point that it dictates what we do. And these aren't ungodly principles. This isn't anything new. It's not anything radical. It's just biblical principles, foundational things that God had just called the church back to. Commitment to the Word. That's not something we ought to have to tell you, but it is something we need to be reminded of. Commitment to discipleship. We're called to be disciples. We're called to make disciples. But I'm not convinced the church does that and does it very well. And as God laid this on my heart, I realized we have to make a commitment as a church to discipleship. Preaching is wonderful, and I love to preach. But I tell you what, I get more excited about teaching, because you can only get this deep in the Word with preaching. It may tickle you and make you warm and fuzzy, and it may bring conviction, and that's what it's intended to do. But the reality is, you don't learn very much in preaching. If you want to learn, you have to be discipled. You have to have time for teaching. And in the Pentecostal movement, we have some of the most powerful preaching of any denomination. And what it has done, it has spoiled the children of God. It has spoiled the people of God in this movement, to where if we have somebody that teaches, oftentimes I've seen this in a Pentecostal church, say, well, if that's all they're going to do is Bible study, I can stay at home and read my Bible. Two things that tells me. One, it tells me that you're not very mature in the Lord. The other thing it tells me is you won't stay home and read that Bible. Because if you would, I'd just assume read it in front of others where we can learn together. If you're committed to that, where are you going to be there? But I've heard these things. So we changed it the time we had a Sunday night service. And this is, I'm going to tie the message into it, but this is important. We changed the way we did business as a church. Our Wednesday nights became a Bible study. We got to be committed. I can't just get up here and ask you to commit to growing in the Lord if I don't give you opportunities as the pastor. I'm going to be accountable to God. So we changed the way we did things. And guess what? Folks stopped coming on Wednesday, not completely. Those of you that come on Wednesday now, it's wonderful. It still blesses me. But those of you that come, you know, I hand out little questions every week. And here's how I know how much we've grown. I print these copies. I make the little questions up. And I used to print 10 copies of questions to hand out, because that's how many adults we had. And that would give me enough to give everybody one and have a couple extra in case we had a visitor or a couple extra folks. 10 copies. I make 100 copies now. Just for the adults. There was a time in our Wednesday night where we were talking about giving the youth this room, because they had about 20 kids coming and we had less than 10 adults. So we were going to swap rooms. The Lord said, no, hold on. Just be faithful. Stay the course. I'm telling you that because we were committed to it. I felt like, as a conviction to the Lord, I couldn't go back. God had put this burden on my heart, and we'd die on this hill. We have to be committed to this discipleship. And it did begin to grow. There are people that are hungry for the Word. It changed at the time we did Sunday night service, and it changed our Sunday night service. We went to discipleship classes. And guess what? The attendance did this. Some of our faithful people stopped coming. They were coming while we had preached. But if we're going to teach, well, I don't know about that. If we're going to grow in the Lord, we have to be taught. Here's what the Lord showed me
back in 2010, this school of discipleship, here's where it all came from. I speak of the Lord giving me visions, and they're not always these big fancy dreams. Sometimes it's just the Lord showing me a picture of something. So when I refer to a vision, it's not necessarily some big supernatural experience. And God speaks to me in ways that I can understand. My father went for a little season of his education to a single room schoolhouse. Most of us don't know what it's like to go to that little single room schoolhouse where they taught first grade all the way through 12th grade. The Lord showed me in this vision that little schoolhouse. And God began to ask me questions. So what was the goal of the school back then? It was to make graduates. It's always been to make graduates. The goal of the school has never changed. The methods have changed. The reason is because most people, my father was the baby of nine. He was the first one and the only one in his family to graduate high school. My mother didn't graduate high school. The goal was always to make graduates, and we hoped that we would. But when we put them in that little schoolroom, most people did not graduate. The reason being is because we expected them to make disciples of themselves, make students of themselves. If you would take the book home, you would graduate. If you would take the book home and do the work, you had a facilitator, you had a teacher that was there, and she would facilitate, or he would facilitate. They would help you in your journey. But that shotgun blast approach didn't work. You couldn't just get up and blast information because it's going to be over the first grader's head. Or if you teach to the first grader, it's going to be so far beneath that kid that's in ninth grade sitting in that same room that he's not getting anything out of it. And God began to show me this is what the church is. It has that shotgun approach. We bring people in and we preach the word to them, but we're not intentional about making disciples. The goal is to make disciples. The goal is to see people graduate. The reality is, in that environment, most don't. God began to show me something. Right now, if you look, and not that our public schools, I'll tell you, they're not perfect, and certainly they're flawed. But the reality is the system now works where it didn't used to work. The large majority, the overwhelming majority of kids that enter that school system will walk across that stage. They will graduate. Right? Because they've changed their method so that they can be intentional about making graduates. What they've done is they've taken kids at a very early age and they said, we're going to teach you the basics that you need so that you can advance to the next level. And then there we'll teach you a little bit more. We'll build on what you've already learned and we'll take and teach you everything you need to know to go to the next level. And the ultimate goal is to create such a model that you can successfully go out and live this life. I'm going somewhere with this. And listen, God began to show me every year, and we just graduated classes all over the state this year. And with bittersweet tears, there were families in the audience watching their babies grow up and walk across the stage, and this is it. And there's administrators that watch some of these kids that they've poured into. There's kindergarten teachers sitting there and they look back and they think, you know, I watched this child grow. They couldn't even tie their shoe. And they're walking across the stage. And with tears in their eyes, they'd watch and say, you know what, this one will never come back. And many of those kids will never come back to the school. Some will. And when they come back, they'll be teaching their teacher's kids or their grandkids. And God began to show me, if the church is truly healthy, we'll constantly be losing some of our finest people. Now that sounds a little odd because we've gotten so possessive in the church that we don't want to lose anybody that's good, that can add to our church. But if we're doing our job, we ought to constantly have preachers that are being called to leave this place. We ought to constantly have missionaries that feel such a burden out of this place that they walk across that stage and we weep bitter tears because they're not coming back here, but they're going on to do greater things for the glory of the Lord. And while some of them we may lose for a season, they may come back and they may one day preach and pastor our kids or our grandkids. And I looked this morning and Sister Linda, you know, when I met her, Plant Springs, I wasn't even saved. I look now and I get to minister to her granddaughter. But they had to lovingly let me go. There came a time where, with tears in their eyes, they loved this young couple, but there was a time for us to go. For the glory of the Lord, and the little church needed us, but God needed us. And the assignment had to change. What are you getting at? I'm not convinced that the church does a good job of making disciples. If my daughter, she'll graduate next year. If my daughter walks across that stage next year and they hand her that diploma, and she comes home with this big grin on her face, so excited because finally she's made it, finally she's arrived, and she says, "Dad, can you read to me? Tell me what it says." I said, "Baby, you read it." "I don't know how." You think I'm going to be mad at her? I'm going to be furious with the school. Because at that point, she will have spent 13 years of her life, and you haven't taught her what she needs to know. So I look at the church today, and the reality is, in the church, there are people that have been in church longer than I've been alive. And you ask one of them to teach a Sunday school class, and I say, I can't do that. That tells me, now, there was a time, and until God showed me this vision, here's the way my mindset worked. I used to look, and right or wrong, it's what I did. I said, "God, there's some lazy people in the church. You ask them to do anything, they don't want to do anything." And God began to convict me with that vision. He says, "You're blaming the wrong people. You're blaming the kid that can't read when the system has failed and the church has failed to make a disciple of them." The number one reason nobody will tell, or not nobody, the number one reason many people won't tell anyone about Jesus Christ is because they don't feel like they know enough to share. You don't have to be an expert in your field, but this is what I found. If you know how to braid hair and I don't, I say, "Can you show me how to braid?" "You know, I've never done this for a living." Nobody even says that. "Well, sure, I'll teach you what I know." We're excited. If somebody asks us something that we're comfortable explaining, we'll tell them. We don't claim to be an expert. But it's funny how we ask them to share the gospel. "Well, I'm not a preacher. Can you tell me about couponing?" "Well, I don't claim to know it all, but let me show you what I do." Can you tell me how to do what you do for a living?" "Well, I can show you everything that I know." Have you ever noticed that we're not afraid to talk about the sale? We say, "Well, I'm not comfortable around people." But we'll be quick to tell them where we got that cute outfit or that cute purse. I mean, a perfect stranger. "Where'd you get that?" "Oh, let me tell you, sister, it was..." Am I right? You got something far better than a cute outfit. You got Jesus Christ. You got salvation. Hey, guys, we're quick to talk about the ball game, the race. We're quick to talk about politics. We're quick to talk about what we do for a living. Say, "Well, I just don't..." Why is it that we won't share Jesus Christ? So rather than point my finger and say, "You know what? There's a lot of lazy people in the church anymore," I'm pointing the finger back at the church and saying, "You know what? Maybe if the church had done a better job of making disciples, we'd have people that would go out and tell the world about Jesus Christ." So here's what this model of discipleship is. It's a school of discipleship. I hadn't changed the name. I said, really, because it's more than just a class. The vision of this thing is, simply put, how do you take a man or a woman off the street that's never even heard the name of Jesus? And you may think in this country that doesn't happen. I'm telling you, it does happen. I'm telling you, we've had people walk in the door of this church that have never heard of Jesus Christ. That's the truth. So how can you take somebody like that and adequately take them from not even knowing that name to the point where they could tell somebody else about Jesus to the point of salvation? They don't have to be called to preach, but they can share what they know. Our graduates will walk across that stage, and while most of them don't feel prepared, they're excited. But then they start getting scared because they think, "Oh my gosh, it's really happening now. Somebody's going to expect something of me." And we all of us in here, for the most part, we know what that's like to walk across that stage feeling like we finally arrived, and in the back of our mind thinking, "Oh my gosh, I really don't know anything. I put up a good front. I've convinced mom and dad I know everything." Scared to death because we're not sure we can succeed. But the reality is that you have been given, every kid that walks across that stage, they've been given the basic tool. They really can succeed. Whether it's to go on to college or go out in the workplace, they've been given the basic tools. Now, they've still got to go out and work it out. They've got to go and exercise it, but they have every tool that they need to succeed, right? This is the way it ought to be in the church. So our goal is to take and make disciples intentionally, from start to finish. And this process in my head, listen to me this morning, we've not worked it all out yet. We're building this bridge as we drive across it. Sister Drew Smith, Jamie's mother, she has been working very diligently for the last year. This vision has been in my heart for 5 years now. So it's not a haphazard thing. It's not just some great idea. To me, you say, 5 years. I've shared it with a couple of my elders over the course of the few years, and I've been fishing for information from various people. I mean, strangers I'd run into. And they'd start talking about this. Tell me what you're doing. Send me some notes on it. But what the Lord had showed me in this vision was so big, it's kind of like eating an elephant. I didn't know where to start. And about 2 years ago, God began to show me that I put people around you. There's about 5 or 6 teachers that go to church, maybe more than that, professional administrators. And God began to show me, you can stop making excuses now for why you won't eat that elephant. I've put people around you. I didn't call you to do everything, but equip the saints. So Sister Drew has been working very diligently for the last year, helping me write curriculum for this first part and gather curriculum. And we want to build it. Basically, here's what it is. It's going to be like Sunday school. But we want to be able to take you through the basics of your faith. The truth is, in the church, oftentimes, even those, especially those of us that have been in for a long time, there's things that we don't understand, and there's some church lingo, and sometimes we use church words, and we really don't know what they mean, but we don't want to be the one to ask, because after all, we've been in church so long, we should just know that. So oftentimes, we don't even know what we believe. By the way, I feel like the church can do a better job. I feel like the church should do a better job. I feel like the church is commissioned by God to do a better job. This is what it's all about. So I want to encourage you. We want to, this program in my mind may be 3 years long. But you think about it. Jesus Christ took his handful of men, 12 men. They devoted 3 years of their life to follow Christ. And when he left them, they were like these high school seniors. Well, they were a wreck. They didn't think they could live without him. Peter said, I'm going back to fishing. I don't know anything about this. But the reality was every tool that he needed was there. Christ showed back up, kind of like the graduation day, the day of Pentecost fell. And it was basically a reaffirmation. Look, you have everything that you need. All power, all authority is given to me. Go out and make disciples. This is the commission we have in the New King James. It says this, Matthew 28. Jesus came and spoke to them. Jesus said this, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples. That's what he says for us to do. I don't think we've done it. We've preached, but if all we ever do is this shotgun approach, it's no wonder. The people that end up graduating or the people that become disciples, even as pastors, here's the way it works. Same way it worked for me. We're hoping that somebody will take the book home, do the work themselves, and come in one day to the teacher, come into the preacher and say, I feel like God's called me to do something. God's called all of us to do something. But many will spend our whole life in the church and never realize, not because we weren't faithful. Lord knows you're faithful. But either because we never made ourselves available to be taught, or the church never made teaching available. So with this school of discipleship, I want to encourage you to be a part of it. Right now, it'll go on during Sunday school. It would bless my heart if I showed up next Sunday and there's nobody in here to preach to but the sound guy and the computer guy. Because everybody wants to grow in their walk with the Lord. At the end of this model, it will become very advanced. I want to equip the saints for the work of God. I believe we'll know we're healthy when we're constantly losing good people. I'll wrap it up with this. When's the last time you saw a missionary get called out of your church? If we're healthy, I think we'll be losing. We'll constantly have youth ministers that are leaving us and constantly have children's ministers that are leaving us because God's called them to something, and some of our best people. Amen? Praise the Lord. The title of my message this morning is Great Commission or Great Omission. The Lord brought me back to remembrance of something I preached a while back because of this that He's put on my heart. Like I said with you, this isn't new for me. I'm excited to kind of see it come to pass and finally see it take some life. But I'll be brief this morning. Let's start out with this. Fireman's Creed. Do we have any first responders, nurses? I know, Brother Bobby, you were talking. Raise your hand. Will you stand this morning if you're a nurse, first responder? If you got any of you guys, I know there's several. Would you let these folks know you appreciate them this morning? I'm going to set this up. I'm glad these guys go through extensive training. I was taught first aid when I was in the military, and I was taught the CPR and all this stuff, but I'm going to be honest. I prayed, Lord, I hope I never need, because I didn't feel like I had enough training to actually use it. I was afraid because I didn't have enough training, if I ever needed it, I wouldn't remember it. See, these folks, the difference is they go through, even after they know it, they don't just say, okay, well, you learned that way back in, we don't ever need to teach it again. They constantly get retrained the same things they already know, because if not, they'll get rusty. I praise the Lord for our firemen and our firewomen and our policemen and our policewomen, because they constantly get trained. I praise the Lord that they don't hand an 18-year-old a machine gun in this country and say, you're now going to be in our military. Give them some kind of training. I don't feel so comfortable with them having a gun if they don't know how to use it and which end to hold and who to aim it at and who not to aim at. Amen? I want them trained. Fireman's Creed. When I am called to duty, God, wherever flames may rage, give me strength to save a life, whatever be its age. Help me to embrace a little child before it is too late, or save an older person from the horror of that fate. Enable me to be alert, to hear the weakest shout, and quickly and efficiently to put the fire out. I want to fill my calling and to give the best in me, to guard my neighbor and protect his property. And if according to your will I have to lose my life, bless with your protecting hand my children and my wife. It's a fireman's creed. Here's a fireman's oath. My duty is to protect those that I serve from whatever danger they may face, whether it be fire, demon, or angel, no matter the danger. I will protect the people to the best of my ability. I am but a servitor of the people. My duty is to those who I serve and no one else. I serve the people without fear, without remorse, without fail. My duty is to the people. By my fireman's oath, I am bound to protect those who are in danger, those in times of need, those who I would serve. Upon my honor as a firefighter, this is my creed. Our doctors take an oath to do no harm. I think it's wonderful to know what it is that we stand for and to fulfill our duty. I see firemen, and I'm laying a foundation. Please be patient with me this morning. I see firemen very diligently washing the fire trucks on a regular basis. Is their job to wash the fire trucks or to put out fires? Both. Their job, their main responsibility is to put out fires, but it needs to be done. Not just the washing the truck, but the maintaining, to make sure that they run. What a terrible tragedy to have a fire, but the vehicle is not in good repair. Let me flip it this way. The church does not exist just to have nice buildings. The purpose of the church isn't just to have nice stuff. The purpose of the church is to save souls. If we're constantly just dressing up the church and never putting out the fires, what good are we? I believe that hell is real. I believe there's a lot of folks in danger of burning. Praise God for the fire trucks. Praise God for the nice buildings. But we have a job to do whether we have fire trucks or not. We have a job to do whether we have buildings or not. We have a job to do, souls to save, whether we have a van or not. Whether we have air conditioning working or not. Whether we have a classroom to offer the training. We have a responsibility and an obligation to save souls. Do you agree with me, church? Amen. I want to play this short video if the sound will work. Sound not going to work? Had some technical difficulties this morning, so.
A house goes up in flames and firefighters don't respond despite the homeowner's plea for help.
I hadn't paid my $75, and that's what they want, $75, and they don't care how much they burn down.
Imagine your home catches fire, but the local fire department first won't respond, then watches it burn.
That's exactly what happened to a local family tonight. A local neighborhood is furious after firefighters watched as an Obion County, Tennessee home burned to the ground. The homeowner says he offered to pay whatever it would take for firefighters to put out the flames, but was told it was too late, and they wouldn't do anything to stop his house from burning. Each year, Obion County residents must pay $75 if they want fire protection from the city of South Fulton. This family did not pay. And the mayor says if they don't pay, they're out of luck. Local 6's Jason Hibbs joins us now with our top story tonight. And Jason, we've talked about this issue before. A home's on fire, but the family didn't pay the $75 fee, so the fire department doesn't respond. What finally got those firefighters to leave the station?
Well, Jennifer, this fire went on for hours because garden hoses just wouldn't put it out. Now, it wasn't until that fire spread to a neighbor's property that the fire department would respond. It turns out the neighbor had paid the fee.
I thought they'd come out and put it out, even if you hadn't paid your $75. But I was wrong.
And because of that, this is all that's left of Gene Kranick's house. They called 911 several times, and initially the South Fulton Fire Department would not come.
What a tragedy. Praise the Lord. What a tragedy. Can you imagine how sickening it must be to have what you need so close, but they won't do anything? What about their oath? What about their creed? What about their job? But nobody will jump in. Am I the only one that this infuriates? I mean, can you imagine? This is people that you... I thought if I didn't pay that somebody would bring it to me anyway. I thought that they would help me in my time. And listen, before we get up on our high horse, I say, what about the church? What about our oath? What about the Great Commission? What a tragedy to have what you need. Jesus is the answer. What a tragedy to have what you need so close, but nobody will respond. Is it the Great Commission or the Great Omission? A commission means something that we are charged to do. It is something that we are commanded to do. Omission is when we fail to respond or fail to answer the call. And I'm afraid today that no different than this. Look, that's just a house. Praise the Lord, nobody died. If my memory serves me correct, I think a couple of pets died in that fire so tragically. But that's just temporal. What about all eternity? Is the church not concerned for the lost? We assume someone else will take up the charge. Listen, what a man needs when he's stuck in a fire isn't a fire truck. He needs a way out. What are you getting at? What your friend needs, this bound up in sin, isn't a nice, warm, fuzzy church. It's not even a loving church. They need a way out. They need Jesus Christ. But what the church is famous for doing, and maybe this is why we need discipleship. What the church is famous for doing is trying to point them back to the fire truck. Let me take you to a nice church, but they need a way out. I don't need another fire truck on the scene when I'm trapped in the house and I can't get out. I need a way of escape. When we're bound up in our sin, should we invite people? Absolutely. But we ought to be armed with the gospel enough to give somebody a way out and then invite them to church. Are you with me? But that doesn't happen. And for most of us in here, it didn't happen that way. Somebody gave us an invitation. And praise the Lord that somebody was faithful to deliver the water of God, the living water from behind the pulpit. But they shouldn't have had to wait for another fire truck. You should have been capable. Someone else should have been capable. Again, I'm not putting the blame on you. I'm saying maybe the church failed for years. The reality is we have so many people today that are dying. And the truth of the matter is there's some people that we love, people that we go to church with. There's some people that live in our house. There's some people that we work with. There's some of our closest family and some of our closest friends that are dying and going to hell. And we have what they need so close, so readily available, but we omit. We fail to respond. What about this? If somebody finally realized one day that putting out fires is hazardous duty, it's dangerous. Sister Linda knows her son, my friend Jeff, gave his life trying to save others. So what if upon realizing how dangerous it was, we said, you know what? Let's do this and we'll never have to lose another fireman. We'll take and just let the fire trucks do all the work. Well, that's just silly. No one will ever get saved. What if we just said, let's let the church do all the work? The church isn't the building. The church is you. Or what if we said, well, that's just nonsense. The fire truck can't do anything. So let the fire chief handle it all. After all, it's his or her job. I wonder how many people would have to die before we realize that won't work. So I wonder how many people are going to have to die and go to hell before we finally realize the pastor can't do it all. Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye, doesn't say go preacher, go ye. Therefore, and teach all nations, or make disciples. Teach all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and know this, that I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Here's the thing, folks. We've got to finally get to the recognition that we're part of this. That if people are going to live and not die, then we have to step up to the plate. We've got to be willing to be a firefighter. We've got to be willing to step into the game. We've got to be willing to go. Nothing happens until we go. Nothing happens until we're willing to step out on faith. Nothing happens until we're willing to be a vessel that God can use. The Bible says, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water. I believe today that the church, for whatever reason, and like I said, I'm willing to bear responsibility as a pastor and say that we've failed the people and we've not trained our firemen and we've not given them adequate tools to go out and show others the way out. If we were just to stop this morning and reflect, and I want us to do this for a moment, not about everybody else, but about you. Do you feel like you're fulfilling the Great Commission, or are you just omitting that it's your responsibility? We're coming in and we're just tending to the church. I'm going to be honest, and this is going to sound funny coming from a preacher, but I think sometimes what a waste this building and the lights and all that stuff is. I have a heart for the lost, and I think, and I've said this to people before, I said, you know, think of the ministry we could get done if we didn't have a church to keep up. The sad reality is in this country, nobody would come if we had to stand in the open, if we had tent services every week. Oh, it's exciting every once in a while for the property, but Pastor, I think I'm going to find me a new fire truck. I'm going to find me a new building because, you know, it's a little warm over here. And you got other parts of the world where they don't have these conveniences, and men will walk for days to hear a man preach because they never get that treat. Just so he can go back and tell somebody else. He's not coming just to be entertained. He's coming to be equipped. And here we have all the creature comforts. And if you knew how much money, even in this little church, it's not like a home, what our utility bills run, and just what it costs to maintain. And I think about people that are dying and going to hell, when it wouldn't be a bad investment if we were making disciples. And listen, I don't care if people get saved and never come to this church, as long as they get saved. I'll travel across state lines and minister to people that I know will never come to this church, and that doesn't bother me a lick. I'm not interested in filling up chairs on Sunday or Wednesday. I'm interested in filling up the kingdom. Listen. Nothing happens until we go. The fire department was called, but they failed to respond. They called and they just stood there. Here's what Matthew 22:14 says. For many are called, but few are chosen. And that verse may not mean what you think it means. What it really means is that we're all called, but many fail to answer the call. Few fail to answer the call. The fire department was called, but they failed to respond. I'm telling you, the church, you've been called, but we failed to respond. We'll watch our brothers, we'll watch our co-workers, and we know that their life is leading them down the path of destruction. They may have a nice home, they may have a nice family, but they don't have salvation. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Friends, listen, I am burdened to my core because I am convinced the church is asleep, the church is blind, the church doesn't care. I don't understand. But here's what I do believe with all of my heart. If any of us believe that there is a real hell, it would compel us to beat upon every door until our knuckles were so bloody that the bones were exposed, because we would not, the humanity in us would beg and plead with us that just maybe one more knock will wake somebody up. If we truly believed that there was a hell, we wouldn't care. I know, as my brothers sometimes, they don't want to hear me preach to them. I understand that. But I also understand if you don't get out of this mess, you're going to die in it. So I'll knock up on that door when you don't want to be woke up. So I'm convinced that the church must not believe that hell is real, or maybe we don't believe he's coming back. I believe he's coming back. I believe that hell is real, and I believe it's worth exhausting myself. I believe it's worth giving my life on this side of glory, that hopefully one more might not make it to that fate. I'm willing to be out of my comfort zone. I'm willing to be made ashamed in front of other people. I'm willing to be mocked or ridiculed. I'm willing to be talked about, whatever it takes. And not because I'm super spiritual, but just because I believe that hell is real. In my mind, I've envisioned it this way for years, long before I was preaching. If I lived in a high-rise apartment complex, and I saw the flames rising up in the building, and I saw the smoke ascending, listen to me, I believe with all of my heart, even if I wasn't a saved man, I believe the humanity in me. I believe I'm a decent person. I don't believe I'm good, but I'm a decent person. I believe the humanity, even if I were not a Christian, would plead with me to go running out of that knocking on every door. I believe that I would not be able to pass one door on my way out. I'm not saying that I would linger in the building. But I don't believe the humanity in me would let me run past one door. If it were 20 stories high, I believe that by the time I got to the bottom, my knuckles would probably be exposed to the bone. I don't know how they wouldn't, because there's no way that I would gently tap as to not offend it. You know, in case somebody's sleeping, I don't want to disturb them. I don't want to make them. No, baloney, I would want to get up. The humanity would compel me to such degree that whatever it cost me, I could not pass them by. They must wake up. Are you with me? So if that's the reality, and I believe that it's the same truth for you, then why in the world isn't the church knocking on the door? Well, I don't want to offend anyone. You're going to let them sleep until they perish? Well, you know, my kids don't want to hear it. Let me tell you something. I said it many times from behind this pulpit. Because people get offended when you talk about hell. And so there are preachers today that won't preach it. I'm telling you, the one that's going to be offended one day is the man that's burning in hell that sat in a church one Sunday and the man lied to him and didn't tell him the truth. I'd rather you be offended with the truth than one day be offended with a lie, because I didn't want to make you uncomfortable. So I don't get it. I'm not convinced that the church really believes that hell is real. because I can't fathom in my mind how we could pass up. Now, I understand the weakness of this flesh. I wrestle with it too. I'm not holier than thou. I miss it many times. There are times where I'm afraid. There are times where I'm intimidated. One of the most impactful events that ever happened in my life spiritually, I was in line, I believe it was at Bilo years ago. And there was a young woman in front of me in the grocery store in the line. The Holy Spirit began to deal with me to witness to her. So the first thing that went through my mind is, Lord, I don't know her. And I wrestled with the Lord, and the Holy Spirit wouldn't release me. And I started saying to myself, you know, I'm a married man. She might think that I'm flirting with her or something. And I made one excuse after the other excuse, after the other excuse, until finally she had checked out and she went out the door. Man, I'm telling you what, God whooped me like he's never whooped me before. Not a condemning, abusive whooping, but a convicting, a loving, a chastisement from the Father. God began to prick my heart and say, now what if she goes out and she gets in an accident and you were the last one? That changed me that day. I didn't get a chance to go and make it right, and I don't know what may have happened. I believe upon the grace of God that God was gracious to her, and I believe that God used it to teach me. Holy Spirit got a hold of me, and I'm better now than I used to be, and I'm not going to tell you that I get every one of them now, because the truth is I still wrestle with this flesh, and there are times where there's other people in line, and what will they think? And there are times where they might just think I'm weird. They might laugh. Who cares? Come on. What if you beat upon that door and somebody yells on the other side, leave me alone, I'm busy. It's on fire. I don't believe it. I don't care if you believe it. I'm looking out for you. I don't care if you leave this building and you're angry with me because I woke you up from a sound sleep. I don't care if you're angry because I disturbed your sleeping child. And one day when you see the truth, you'll not be angry with me. And some of us, we can relate. There was a time in our life we didn't want to hear anybody preach to us. But now that we know the truth, oh man, we think back to that person that wouldn't stop beating on the door, and we say, man, I'm glad you didn't give up on me. Mama, I'm glad you didn't stop praying for me. You know, I didn't even want to come over to your house because all you ever did was talk about God. But now I look back and I'm so glad you didn't stop. I'm so glad you wouldn't stop beating on the door. I'm so glad you didn't give up on me. We're called, church. We're called, but how many are responding? Many are called, but few choose to answer the call. And when we make excuses, well, you know, I don't know how to witness to people, and I don't know enough about the Bible. And while these may be very good excuses, they're really not a valid reason. Listen to me, that's all it is at the end. It's just an excuse. The same thing that flooded my mind, the devil knows what he's doing. If you won't knock on that door, that's just another one that'll die in the flames. So I can get you to make enough excuses, you're too busy, or you don't know enough, or it's just not the right situation. Would it matter that the most important business and board meeting was going on when that fire raged? Would you pass by the boardroom door and say, well, they're having a very important meeting, I can't disturb them right now? No. What I'm getting at is there's never an inappropriate time. Never, never, never. But the devil will fill your mind so full of excuses that maybe, just maybe, you'll pass by one more door. Because the reality of the fate is sealed if somebody doesn't knock upon that door and wake them up. I can tell you where I'd be dead. I'd be on my way to hell if I wasn't dead already, if somebody hadn't knocked upon my door. But I wonder how many people passed by. If you knew me before, you would know pretty assuredly I didn't want what you had. How many times we've let ourselves off the hook because we said, they don't want to hear it. That doesn't fit into the lifestyle that they're living. It doesn't make any difference. They need it. Listen. He said this. What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Mark 8. Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he come in his glory of his Father with the holy angels. This is the reality is, again, we're not afraid to talk to people. So I'm not comfortable, but you'll tell them about them shoes. You'll tell them about that sale. You'll tell them about this great new restaurant. It's funny how you'll stand in line at the supermarket and hear somebody have a conversation about, hey, have you been to this new restaurant? And they're, no, I heard it was good. All of a sudden you'll chime in, the perfect stranger, say, I've been there, it's fantastic. Or you'll chime in and say, you don't want to go there. So we're really not as uncomfortable as we like to excuse ourselves as being. What it boils down to is the shame of the message. Because we think to ourselves, you know, my brother doesn't want to hear this anymore. Same thing I thought in line. I had 101 excuses that kept flooding through my head, and as soon as I would squash one, another one would just pop up. With my own father, I made excuses. And every time that I'd get the boldness to just try a little bit, the moment that he would give me the least resistance, I would excuse myself as saying, well, I tried. Now listen to me. Apartment complex were on fire. I'm quite confident I wouldn't linger in the hallways. But when I got to my father's door, I would stop and probably risk my life. When I got to my children's door, I could see myself dying in the fire before I would pass until they came and answered that door. See, there are certain people that just mean so much to me that if it cost me everything, I cannot pass you by. So I don't understand. This was my personal conviction even with my father. I would go home and I would wrestle. Why is it so easy to preach to the world and so difficult to witness to my father? And the Holy Spirit began to deal with me and challenged me. He said, you say that you love him. And of course, my answer, of course I love him. He's my dad. And God began to say, what kind of love is this that you'll let him die? You know. I couldn't sleep at night. And yet I still had excuses. He lived in Newberry, so I could put it off and, you know, make an excuse so I couldn't get up there. Finally, that thing began to eat at me because I couldn't sleep. I'm telling you what, I'd wake up out of a cold sleep. I'd wake up sweating and think, oh my gosh, I say I love him. Well, I'm lying. I am absolutely lying. If I love the man, how in the world can I let him die like this? And I began to pray, God, give me boldness. Give me boldness to knock on that door. I shared with you the testimony before, but when I did, it would be a splendid testimony if we knelt down in the living room floor that day and he gave his life to the Lord. It didn't happen that way. Shared the word, and I planted the seed, and he distracted me three times trying to show me a gun. And each time I said, Pop, please. I was almost in tears. I said, I love you, and I need to talk to you. We sat down. I said, Daddy, I love you, and I need to know when you die that you're right with the Lord. His response, son, I'm a good man. I said, Daddy, he didn't say anything about being a good man. He said, I'm good. And he said, let me show you this gun. Just tried to distract me. Any other time that would have worked. Every other time it had worked. I couldn't sleep with myself at night because I've been living a lie because I did love this man, but not enough to save him from the pit of hell where I was confident that he was going. There was no reason for me to have hope otherwise. So he stood up from the table. I said, Pop, please. I love you. I need to talk to you. Let me finish. And he sits back down. And the moment it gets uncomfortable again, he says, Son, I'm good. Let me go show you this new gun. No, please. Just hear me out. And he sits back down, and I finish. And I present to him the gospel. Daddy, it doesn't say anything about being a good man. You are a good man. But the Bible makes it clear, none are good. All of our righteousness is as filthy rags. Apart from Jesus Christ, we cannot be saved. There's no way of salvation except through Him. And I laid the gospel message out, and he tried to tell me about how he went to church as a boy. Listen, I had never seen my father in church. He'd cuss enough to make a sailor blush. Not that his words necessarily mean he's not saved, but there was no fruit in his life. Now, I could walk away from there so that I wouldn't have to be uncomfortable, and he could feel good about himself, because after all, he did go to church some when he was a little boy. Had a certificate from way back in the 40s where he went to vacation Bible school. What difference does it make? And I promise you, he was a good man. He'd give you the shirt off his back. But he wasn't a saved man, and all I could think about is if I sit there at his funeral one day as a preacher, and let my own dad go to hell because I was uncomfortable. So here's what happened. He didn't give his life to the Lord that day. This was in 2007, the same year we came to pastor this church. I believe that was in March. May came around, and I was preaching Sunday night at our old church in May. And as I was up behind the pulpit, I must have just started the message, because I looked through the door and I watched my dad walk in. I was very surprised. And he didn't come to give his life to the Lord. He just come to hear his boy preach. You want to talk about being surprised? When I gave the altar call that night, he was the first one out of his seat, and I couldn't believe that he walked through the door. I knew why. He was there for me. He wasn't there for Jesus. What I didn't understand was the power of the seed that I had planted that day. You ever notice how one little seed can break up concrete? I mean, it's amazing. A little piece of grass will bust your concrete all up. All it's got to do is find enough dirt to land in, and it'll begin to break up the most hardened of hearts. I underestimated the value of the seed that I planted that day. And in May, he gives his life to the Lord. I did not even know. He didn't even know he was sick. In August of that year, we took the church the last Sunday of July in 2007. The beginning of August, found out my dad was sick. He couldn't hardly even pick his feet up. Pleaded with him to go to the doctor. By the time he went, cancer had surrounded both of his lungs in that main branch. And he went for a biopsy. He went for a biopsy and had a complication. The mass was so big, when they rolled him over on his side, it cut off blood flow to the main artery in the heart, and he had a heart attack. Didn't die from the heart attack, but because he had lung cancer and his lungs were shot, they put him on the ventilator because of the heart attack, and I had never spoke to him again. Listen, why do you share that? Because in the back of my mind, while I was making excuses for all those years, I was pleading with God, you know, one day on his deathbed, he'll want to hear it then. And I won't be ashamed then, and I won't be scared, and I won't be intimidated. But here's the truth of it. God taught me a lesson with that. If I'd have waited till his deathbed, he'd have never got to hear it. He was so doped up on morphine, he didn't know if he was still in this world. He couldn't talk. He had a tube down his throat. So I praise the Lord that in March, see, he didn't come. He didn't give his life to the Lord because he was a sick man. He gave his life to the Lord because finally, I had enough boldness in the Lord to knock on that door. And I didn't think it did any good, and I just kept on moving. But the reality was, it woke something up on the inside. The reality was that seed began to grow and break up that hardened heart. And the grace of the Lord kept him. When I believe that God knew something. I believe God knew something I didn't know. I believe God knew something he didn't know. And I could have been like these firemen and stood by and did nothing. Jesus. It says, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore. What you don't understand is God doesn't expect you to know everything about the Bible. He doesn't expect you to go in your own power. You say, I don't know what to say. This is why he said, all power is given unto me. I send you in my power. Go in my name. Go in my authority. If all I had given him was my word that day, I believe it would have been fruitless. But because it was the word of God, that seed was able to just utterly break up that hardened heart. Stand with me this morning. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Harriet Beecher said this, the greatest thing that one human being can do for another human being is to win them to Jesus Christ. Church, we've been given our marching orders. We've been given this commission from God. It's not just a commission from the city or the county to put out fires. It's a commission from the King of all kings to be a soul winner. If you're here this morning, you said, I need boldness. There are people in my life. I need to knock on their doors. I want you to come. Find you a spot to pray this morning. And you can begin to knock on the door spiritually right now this morning. Maybe you're in the same place that I was, full of good excuses and reasons and discomfort. And I believe the same God that gave this preacher boldness to preach to his own daddy will give you boldness to knock upon the door of your mama, your daddy, your babies, your spouse. I believe today just what the Bible says, while the weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal. God, I'm powerless. But I believe the weapons of our warfare are mighty through God to the pulling down of the strongholds. I know they don't want to hear it. I know they don't want to wake up. I know they don't believe it, God. But it doesn't matter whether they believe. I know there's power in the Word. There are people today that I have on my spiritual hit list. Names that I pray for. They don't even know that I'm praying. You don't even have to know someone's got a gun that pointed at you for it to kill you or to inflict damage. I believe today that there's such power in this word that even when they don't believe it, even when they don't want to hear it, even when they don't know that I'm praying for them, I believe there's power. Church, I'm pleading with you through the power of the Holy Spirit this morning to wake up. He's coming back. He's coming back soon. Heaven is real and it's eternal. Hell is real and it's eternal. It was created for no man. But many men will find themselves in that place having rejected the only way of escape. They don't need another fire truck. They don't need another church. They need the living water, Jesus Christ. And my plea with you this morning is this, that you would be that living water to a lost and dying world, that you would show them the way out. He's the way. He's the answer. There is no problem too big for my God. There is no situation so dire that he cannot save. Oh God, give us boldness. Every head bowed, every eye closed this morning. There's some parents in here. You're so frustrated because your children aren't living like you raised them to live. And you're frustrated and you pray for them. But they don't want to hear it anymore, and it's discouraged you to the point that you don't want to tell it any longer. Because you convinced yourself that you'd rather have them come around some than not come around at all because they don't want to hear it. Oh, Mama, I'm so glad you never gave up on me. I'm so glad you never stopped knocking. Please, please don't give up now. Yes. There are people that you work with.
They don't need a good friend. They don't need another fire truck. They need Jesus. I don't want to be so close and yet not respond. Would you answer that call? When I'm called to my duty, wherever flames may rage, give me strength to save a life, whatever be its age. Help me to embrace a little child before it is too late, or save an older person from the horror of that fate. Enable me to be alert to hear the weakest shout and quickly and efficiently to put the fire out. I want to fill my calling and give the best in me. Today, Lord, I accept your call and I go willingly. God, let that be. Let that be our prayer. Rid us of all excuses. Give us boldness. Give us confidence. Give us courage. Above all, Lord, I pray that you'd give us a burden. I pray, Lord, that you would give vision to your people, Lord, to see the destruction of hell's flames, the reality of death, the reality of heaven and hell, the reality of the life-saving power of this name, Jesus Christ.
For you and for me.
We would go boldly in the authority of that name. Arouse and awake your church, oh God. Just a day. It'll be a day like every other day, but it'll be the day that they don't come home. There'll be a day. It'll be just like the day before, but you'll get that phone call and say, they've passed. Saying that because it could just as easy be today. I want to challenge you because I know how quickly we'll begin to make excuses. If they stay close enough for you to get to them today, go and pay them a visit today. If not, pick up the phone. We don't have Sunday night service, and I know that some of you may already have plans this evening, but so there's always tomorrow. I pray so. Here's the thing, you don't have to condemn them. Jesus didn't come to the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. It may be your spouse, and you don't have to bully them, but you can love them to Jesus. When my dad got frustrated, I said, Daddy, I love you. Please let me finish. You can do simple things like that. I love you, and nothing would bless me more than if you would please listen to what I've got to say. I love you too much. I don't believe there's anything wrong with copying what I've shared with my father. I love you too much, and when something happens, because that day is coming for all of us, when it comes, I want to know, I want to have peace. Where you'll
spend eternity. You say, I love you. Would you please come to church with me if they won't hear the word? I challenge you today, before this day is out, to reach out to some of those. Preaching to the preacher. You pray for me as I pray for you. I'm going to visit some family today after church. Holy Spirit, continue, Father. Let this burden be heavy upon our hearts, Lord. Not to the breaking of a man or woman, Lord, but unto a holy conviction, a reverent fear. God, that we would go and be faithful to witness to those around us, God, just to be a light, to share the hope. God, my prayer today, oh Lord, is that you would bless us with wisdom, bless us with courage and boldness, God. The authority is yours, Lord, and we come boldly in your name, God, even when we don't know what we're saying or what to say. I'm trusting today, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will speak through us, and that seeds will be sown today. Seeds of salvation unto your glory. May you bless these, your people today, God, in Jesus' name.